see the largest impression on the spleen is of the stomach. Okay, this is the gastric impression. This structure here, the blood vessel which we can see, this is the abdominal aorta dividing into the right and the left common iliac artery. Hello everyone, welcome to the second part of this particular session. In the first part, we had covered up till the large intestine. Okay, and in the second part, I'll be covering the remaining topics. So let's begin with the liver and the extrahepatic biliary apparatus. So here we can see the liver viewed from the anterior aspect. So whenever the specimen of liver is given to you, you should know how to hold it in anatomical position. Okay, to hold it in anatomical position, you can use the plain forceps and put it in the inferior vena cava. On the posterior aspect of the liver, there will be inferior vena cava in this region, right? So you can just put the forceps, plain forceps inside it and hold it straight in the right hand. Okay, liver is more towards the right side. So it has to be held in right hand. So that's how it has to be held in anatomical position. Okay. Then the various parts of the liver is the right lobe of the liver, left lobe of the liver. This is the anatomical right and left lobe. There are 8 surgical or the functional segments of the liver as well. Coenaerts liver segments. And here we can see this is the falciform ligament. And there is an anatomical structure in the lower aspect of the falciform ligament. It is referred to as the ligamentum teres hepatis. Okay, it's a remnant of left umbilical vein. Okay, and we'll be asked about the various other folds of the peritoneum. One is the falciform ligament, which goes on the left side as the left triangular ligament, and on the right side there is coronary ligament. There is superior layer of coronary ligament and an inferior layer of coronary ligament. Let's see a different image for it. So here we can see, here is the superior layer of coronary ligament, here is the inferior layer of coronary ligament, and the two layers of coronary ligament continue downwards as the right triangular ligament. Okay, this is the visceral surface of the liver. So in general we can say the liver has got a diaphragmatic surface and a visceral surface. Okay, this is the diaphragmatic surface and this one is the visceral surface where various organs are related. So if we see the relations here, the esophagus is related. Esophagus continues as the stomach, right? So stomach will be related here, and there's a part of stomach called as the pylorus which is related here, and here we can see this is the gallbladder itself which is seen. Then there is first part of the duodenum related in this region. Then the colon, there is a flexure of the colon that is called as the hepatic flexure of the colon is in this region. Okay, and in this region there is right kidney, and right kidney also has got a suprarenal gland above it, so that also is related on the visceral surface. Okay, so various relations on the visceral surface you can remember in anti-clockwise manner. That will be easy to recollect in exams. Okay, and this is the falciform ligament, and also there is a ligament here that is called as the ligamentum venosum. Okay, remnant of ductus venosus. And this is the caudate lobe of the liver, and this quadrangular area here, this is the caudate lobe of the liver. Okay, should know the difference here. And in liver segments, if you study, the caudate lobe is the segment 1 of the liver. Okay, so in liver, basic folds of the peritoneum, then relations of this visceral surface, all these are important as far as practical exams are concerned. Okay, now let's look at the extrahepatic biliary apparatus. So we should know at least the components of the extrahepatic biliary apparatus. So from the liver, hepatic ducts, the bile, they unite to form the hepatic ducts, right and the left hepatic duct, which continue as the common hepatic duct. Okay, and then common hepatic duct is joined by this cystic duct. Okay, cystic duct, it comes from this region. There's the gallbladder. Here we can see the parts of the gallbladder: fundus, body and the neck. The neck of the gallbladder continues as the cystic duct. Okay, then cystic duct and common hepatic duct, they unite to form the bile duct, also referred to as the common bile duct. Okay, then common bile duct unites with the main pancreatic duct. So here we can see the hepatopancreatic ampulla, which opens into the second part of the duodenum. Okay, and this also marks the junction of the foregut and the midgut. Here we can also see the accessory pancreatic duct opening into the minor duodenal papilla. okay, and these ducts are surrounded by sphincters. There is sphincter choledochus, which surrounds the bile duct, sphincter pancreaticus, which surrounds the main pancreatic duct, and this hepatopancreatic ampullae is surrounded by a sphincter called as sphincter of Oddi. Okay, so these at least basic parts of the extrahepatic biliary apparatus we should be knowing. Now let's cover the kidneys. So whenever the kidney is given, you will be asked to identify the side of the kidney and hold it in anatomical position. Okay, so how to identify the side? Just like we identify side of the bones by justifying in three dimensions, similar points we will have to say for the kidney. So here suppose this is the kidney of the left side, and you will have to hold it in the left hand, okay, in such a way that the structures of the hilum of the kidney from anterior to posterior, it should be vein, artery and pelvis, okay, that's the renal pelvis. So anterior most structure should be the renal vein, then the renal artery, and the posterior most structure is the renal pelvis, which continues as the ureter down. Okay, so this is for the anterior posterior relation. For medial lateral, we can say hilum is on the medial aspect. Okay, then what we can say for superior and inferior? For superior and inferior also, this ureter is important. It should be directed downwards in a smooth manner. Okay, it should not kink. If we like hold it upside down, the ureter direction of ureter will be somewhat like this. Okay, this upturning of the ureter is referred to as the kinking of ureter. This kinking shouldn't happen. The ureter should smoothly come down. Okay, so for superior and inferior, we can say the ureter is directed downwards and it is not kinking. Okay, so this was about side determination of the kidney. And in kidney, also you will be asked about the various relations of the kidney. So the relations, anterior relations of the left kidney, if you see, in this region there is the left suprarenal gland, then there is splenic impression, then there is the gastric impression here, and there is a large area for pancreas, pancreatic impression. Then on the medial aspect there is jejunal impression, and on the lateral aspect there is the splenic flexure of the colon. Okay, so here is the colon is related here. Okay, from here it turns down. Okay, so these are the various relations on the anterior aspect of the left kidney. Relations on the anterior aspect of the right kidney, if we see, here there will be right suprarenal gland, and there is a C-shaped second part of the duodenum. Okay, second part of the duodenum, and the large area is covered by liver. Liver is related. Then on the medial aspect, again jejunum and colon. Okay, jejunum and colon are on both sides, left side as well as right side, but make sure jejunum, we label it on the medial aspect, and colon on the lateral aspect, on both the sides. Okay, so this was anterior relations. We should know the posterior relations as well. So here in this image we can see the posterior relations of both kidneys. The left kidney is related with 11th rib as well as 12th rib, whereas the right kidney is related only with the 12th rib. Okay, right kidney is slightly at a lower level, that's why. And apart from that, diaphragm is related along with its ligament, the medial arcuate ligament, the lateral arcuate ligament, and these three nerves, subcostal nerve, iliohypogastric nerve and ilioinguinal nerve, from above downwards. And subcostal nerve is along with the vessels, okay, so along with the subcostal vessels, and three muscles from medial to lateral. It is common for both the sides, psoas major, quadratus lumborum and transversus abdominis. Okay, these are the posterior relations. And in this image we can see the interior of the kidneys. The kidney is cut open along the outer surface, and here we can see on the inner aspect this is the cortex of the kidney and this is the medulla of the kidney. Okay, so you should be able to differentiate which part is cortex, which part is medulla, and from the medulla the minor calyx, major calyx, they arise, which will continue as the renal pelvis. Okay, now let's start with the posterior abdominal wall. So in the posterior abdominal wall, the three muscles which we saw in the posterior relations, psoas major, quadratus lumborum and transversus abdominis, those three muscles will be seen, and various nerves of the lumbar plexus, those are seen. So we should be able to identify these nerves in a particular relation, like from above downwards. So just below the diaphragm there is subcostal nerves and vessels. Then there is iliohypogastric nerve, then ilioinguinal nerve, and there is a nerve which goes towards this anterior superior iliac spine. This nerve is the lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh. Okay, then there will be femoral nerve and a nerve just anterior to the source major, that is genitofemoral nerve, which will split into the two components, genital as well as femoral, and medial to it the nerve will be obturator nerve. Okay, so there will be obturator nerve, and as well as lumbosacral trunk will be seen more on the medial aspect. Okay, so here is the dissected specimen which we can see just in front of the source major. You can appreciate this is the genitofemoral nerve. Okay, and various other nerves, it is not seen very clearly in the image, but at least a basic idea you should know that how the structures are related from above downwards. Okay, so in posterior abdominal wall, muscles as well as nerves, at least these things you should be knowing. Okay, now let's start with the urinary bladder. So here we can see the urinary bladder viewed from the posterior aspect. This is the posterior view. This is the superior surface of the urinary bladder, and this image shows how to hold the urinary bladder in anatomical position. Okay, so we can see it is being held with both the hands. Okay, midline structures always hold with both the hands. If it is a structure of one particular side, hold it on that side. Okay, so here we can see held with both the sides. The four fingers are along the inferolateral surface of the urinary bladder. The thumb is on the superior surface. Okay, that's how it has to be held in anatomical position. And here we can see these are the seminal vesicles as well as the ductus deferens. This should be on the posterior aspect. Okay, and you may be asked whether it is a male urinary bladder or a female urinary bladder. Okay, for that you will have to look for these structures. Ductus deferens and seminal vesicles present only in male, so that's how you can differentiate. Also you can look the prostate gland. If it is present, that means it is a male urinary bladder. Okay, so that's how you can differentiate male urinary bladder from female urinary bladder. Okay, and in these structures you should know which structure is medial, which is lateral. The ductus deferens is on the medial aspect, seminal vesicle is on the lateral aspect. Okay, on the superior surface, the urinary bladder is covered by peritoneum in an empty urinary bladder, but when the urinary bladder gets filled, the peritoneum is reflected from the superior surface of the urinary bladder, such that this superior surface comes to lie in contact with the anterior abdominal wall. Okay, if there is urinary retention, so urine can be drained through a procedure called as suprapubic cystotomy. Okay, now let's look at the interior of the urinary bladder. So here we can see the interior of urinary bladder. So what all things are seen? There'll be one smooth area that is referred to as the trigone of the urinary bladder, and the remaining part, and in the remaining part we can see the mucosal folds of the urinary bladder. Okay, so this smooth part is due to the absorbed mesonephric ducts. Okay, and various parts we should be knowing. There is interuretic ridge called as bar of Mercier, then ureteric orifice. Here we can see small ureteric orifice. Okay, then uretro-urethral ridge. And there is a projection of the prostate here that is referred to as the uvula vesicae. The median lobe of the prostate projects into the urinary bladder, that is uvula vesicae. Then in the lower part you may see the prostate gland. Okay, so this is how the interior looks like. Now let's cover the uterus along with the associated structures, that is the adnexa. So the fallopian tube, ovaries, the vagina, all associated structures along with the uterus, those are referred to as adnexa. Okay, so in the uterus, upper part is the body of the uterus and the lower part is the cervix of the uterus. Okay, and to hold the uterus in anatomical position, it has to be held in both the hands in such a way that ovaries are lying on the posterior aspect. Okay, so ovaries should be on the posterior aspect, and at times uterus may be seen along with the urinary bladder, so in that case urinary bladder should be on the anterior aspect. And the fold of peritoneum here, that is referred to as the broad ligament. The various parts of the broad ligament are important. The part of the broad ligament in relation with the uterus is referred to as mesometrium. The part of the broad ligament in relation with the fallopian tube is called as mesosalpinx, and the part in relation with the ovary that is referred to as mesoovarium. Okay, so various parts of the broad ligament as well as contents of the broad ligament are important. The content of the broad ligament, if is the uterine tube is there, then there are two vessels, the uterine artery, the ovarian artery. There are two ligaments, round ligament of uterus, then ligament of the ovary, okay. Remnants of the mesonephric duct, the epuphoron, paruphoron, all these are there, okay. And in uterus, one of the most frequently asked question is the supports of the uterus. Even in practical as well as in theory exams it is asked, so you should be knowing about the various supports of the uterus. So we can just divide it into primary supports and secondary supports. Secondary supports are nothing but they are folds of the peritoneum that support the uterus. As this primary supports are very important, so further subdivided into three parts: muscular, visceral, and fibromuscular. Okay. In muscular support, there is pelvic diaphragm, perineal body, and urogenital diaphragm. Visceral support includes the organs which are adjacent to the uterus, the urinary bladder, vagina, and the axis, uterine axis. And fibromuscular support are the strongest of the all the supports: the transverse cervical ligament, pubocervical, uterosacral, and the round ligament of the uterus. Okay, amongst all the supports, this is the most important support. Okay, transverse cervical ligament of Meckenrot, it is also referred to as cardinal ligament. Okay, now let's cover the testis. So specimen of testis is along with the spermatic cord. Okay, so you will have to hold the spermatic cord, so that's how one can hold the testis, and in such a way that there is a space here just below the epididymis. This epididymis should be facing on the lateral aspect. Okay, that's how the testis has to be held in anatomical position. And to determine the site, what all site determination points we can say? For superior and inferior, we can say spermatic cord on the superior aspect, or else we can say the epididymis on the superior aspect. For anterior and posterior, we can say the epididymis is on the posterior aspect. Okay, and for medial and lateral, this face is important, that is the sinus of the epididymis that faces laterally. Okay, and the coverings of the testis are important. The outermost covering is of the peritoneum, the tunica vaginalis, then there is tunica albuginea, and the innermost covering is tunica vasculosa. Okay, and here are the various coverings, and the arterial supply is by the testicular artery. Venous drainage is by the pampiniform plexus of veins. And its lymphatic drainage is important because it looks as if it will go towards the iliac lymph nodes, but no, it goes towards the aortic lymph nodes because the arterial supply comes from that region, so that's why lymphatic drainage also goes in that region. Okay, so pre and para aortic lymph nodes are important for lymphatic drainage because whenever there is cancer, it spreads through the lymphatic drainage, right? And varicocele is a condition in which the venous drainage of the testis is affected, so the pampiniform plexus of veins, they get dilated, so that is called as varicocele, and is more frequent on the left side. Now let's look at the mid sagittal section of male pelvis as well as female pelvis. So whenever the mid sagittal section is kept, the first thing that will be asked to you is the whether is it a male pelvis or a female pelvis. Okay, so what all key things we can look for? So in a male pelvis, the external genitals may be seen, but if it is not seen, then you will have to look for the organs which are there. So here we can see this is the urinary bladder and this is the rectum. Okay, in between them we are not able to see the uterus. Okay, that's why this is the mid-sagittal section of a male pelvis. Okay, and you should be able to identify various structures from anterior to posterior. So here is the penis, then this is the pubic symphysis which is seen. Okay, and just this space here is referred to as the retropubic space behind the pubis, right? Then there is the urinary bladder, and here is the rectovesical fold of the peritoneum. Then this is the rectum, and this is the sacrum. Okay, so all these structures we should be able to identify it. Now let's see the female pelvis as well. So here we can see the female pelvis. So again, try to identify structures from anterior to posterior. This is the pubic symphysis. Again, the retropubic space here, then urinary bladder. then here you can see this is the uterus. Okay, so this is the key identification feature for a female pelvis. Okay, so uterus is seen. We continue downward, cervix and the vagina is seen. Okay, and this is the rectum, and behind which there is sacrum. Okay, so all these things we should be able to identify, and there are folds of peritoneum. There is a characteristic fold here that is called as the rectouterine pouch, also called as pouch of Douglas. Okay, so fluid collection most frequently occurs in this region, so clinically very important. Okay, so in male pelvis as well as female pelvis, various structures from anterior to posterior you should be able to identify. Now let's look at some 3D models of abdomen and pelvis. So here we can see the specimen of liver along with duodenum, pancreas and the spleen. Okay, everything together. So let's zoom in and see what all structures are seen. So various parts of the duodenum you can appreciate. First part, second part, third part, and the terminal part is the fourth part, which will continue as the jejunum. Okay, and in pancreas, there is the head of the pancreas, uncinate process, body of the pancreas and tail of the pancreas. Okay, pancreatic duct system is also seen. If I zoom in more, so are you able to see this? This is the duct system of the pancreas. There is a main pancreatic duct which opens into the major duodenal papilla, and there is an accessory pancreatic duct which opens into the minor duodenal papilla. Okay, then in the spleen you can see a characteristic impression. You can see the largest impression on the spleen is of the stomach. Okay, this is the gastric impression. And pancreas is directly shown, the tail of the pancreas. Then here the colon is related, colic flexure, and here is the left kidney which is related. Okay, so this is the visceral surface of the spleen. This is the diaphragmatic surface of the spleen. Let's look at the liver as well. Liver, it is rotated in such a way that we are viewing the inferior surface of the visceral surface of the liver. So here is the caudate lobe, this is the quadrate lobe, this is the ligamentum teres hepatis, this is the region of ligamentum venosum, and this is the inferior vena cava. And for holding in an anatomical position, we have to put the forceps inside this inferior vena cava and hold it straight. Okay, and various relations we learnt here on the visceral surface. Okay, let's look at the diaphragmatic surface as well. Here this is the diaphragmatic surface of the liver, this is the falciform ligament, right, this is the right lobe and this is the left lobe. So it's a very good specimen of liver along with duodenum, pancreas and the spleen. Here there is one more specimen of the abdomen. Here we are looking at the posterior abdominal wall and the various other structures related here. So we can see the kidneys, the left kidney, the right kidney. Then this structure here, the blood vessel, which we can see is the abdominal aorta dividing into the right and the left common iliac artery, common iliac further dividing into the external iliac artery and the internal iliac artery. Okay, external iliac artery will further continue as the femoral artery. Okay, and internal iliac artery, if we trace more further, it will divide into an anterior division and a posterior division, and there will be further multiple branches. So in the posterior abdominal wall also the branches of these blood vessels, aorta, as well as the tributaries of inferior vena cava, these may be asked, so you should be knowing about it. Anterior branches, if we see, there is celiac trunk, superior mesenteric artery and inferior mesenteric artery. Okay, and lateral branches from above downwards, it will be inferior phrenic artery, middle suprarenal artery, renal artery and gonadal artery. Okay, and on the posterior aspect there is four pairs of lumbar artery and there is one median sacral artery. So all these branches of abdominal aorta you should be aware of. And here we can see the psoas major muscle. The nerve running in front of the psoas major is genitofemoral nerve, right? And there will be various other nerves in the posterior abdominal wall from above downwards that we had discussed previously. So this was about the models of abdomen. So let's summarize what we have covered in this particular session. In the first part, I had covered up to the large intestine. Okay, and the second part, I covered liver, extrahepatic biliary apparatus, kidney, posterior abdominal wall, urinary bladder, adnexa, testis, as well as the mid sagittal section of male and female pelvis, and lastly we saw the 3D models. Okay, so I've just tried to quickly revise all the organs, which will be useful for you all to watch it just before the practical or the viva examination. So, details about theory part you all should read. Okay, and for PDF handout of this particular session, you all can WhatsApp me at this number, and please do watch other sessions of this YouTube channel. Okay, thank you.